Good morning, Community Church. I'm always looking for the thumbs up from the guys in the back. So once they give me the thumbs up, we're ready to go. It is time to worship the Lord, to give Him praise, and that is what we're gathered together to do this morning. We are here to love God, to love one another, and to love our neighbors. Amen? Amen. Amen. Welcome, Community Church, to this time of worship and praise together. May our voices be one before the Lord. We look forward to today being the start of Sunday school, and we're very excited about that. We have several different things happening. We have the children downstairs, the young students, the high schoolers. By the way, high school and middle school, watch out because we switched rooms. So if you're high school or middle school, look for the room that is appropriate to you, all right? We're going to have an opportunity to pray for our Sunday school teachers up front here at the end of the service, and so we look forward to that time as well. Also, it is just a blessing to have this season. Adults up here, we're going to have an opportunity to go through the American Gospel. Pastor Don and also David Huff will be helping us through this time of discussion and video, going through a video series called The American Gospel. So look forward to you all staying here, well, maybe getting some coffee, then coming in and staying here in a time of discussion, a time of learning together. We're going to deepen our time by spending a little bit more time in the Word of God. That's a good thing, right? Amen. Amen. Well, if you look in your bulletin, you'll see some of the announcements that are also this week. We do want you to know, we are looking for, we have offered when it is that we have volunteers for this. We have had children's church, appropriate age learning for ages kindergarten to second, third grade for kids during the service. If you feel the Lord tugging you, we don't have volunteers for this yet, but if you feel the Lord tugging you to spend that time or to bless the children, maybe for a couple weeks or for a month or something like that, please talk to me afterwards. You can talk to Coletta or you could talk to Jackie. We'd love to connect you in with having a time for the children and having children's church. Until we have volunteers for that, we will not be having children's church in the service, all right? We'll be having them stay here, which is wonderful. We love the kids staying here and learning from the Word of God as well. So let us bow our heads. Let us prepare our hearts. It is time to worship the King. Father, we come before you in praise and adoration of the goodness of who you are. And today, O Lord, as we study your word, bless us in this way. Teach us, encourage us, strengthen us that we would face the obstacles and the trials and the afflictions that come our way in a godly perspective. So Lord, bless us today as we give you praise. Bless our Sunday school time, Lord. We lift it up to you. We look forward to this day, Lord. We've anticipated it for so long. We are grateful, O God, that you have saved us and have brought us together as your body. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, I said that, and then I do have one more announcement. Next week, if you have one of these books, Pray For Me campaign. If you've been part of this and been praying for a student this past year, please bring your book, all right? Bring it next week. We're hoping to be able to give these to those students who would be here. Some have moved away, and that's okay. We want to acknowledge those who've been praying for the students this past year and also those students that have been prayed for. So next week during our service, we're going to celebrate the Pray For Me campaign. Ask you to bring your books. We're going to have a chance to give that to those children, get them to them. And also, if they've moved away, we will mail them to them as well, so they will be blessed by it. If you've taken any notes or left any messages for them during your time of prayer for them this past year. All right, next week, the 19th. And we also have something else special next week as well. So look forward to that. Brother, let's worship the Lord.
Again, with an ancient greeting in the church, which we know well, the leaders will say, "The Lord be with you," and then you follow with what's on the screen there. Let's stand for this greeting.
The Lord be with you. The Lord of heaven and earth, be worshipped in this place. The covenant of grace be renewed. The Lord be with you. Lord, open our lips.
Well, we've been gone for a few weeks, and it's very good to be back. When I was asked to do the prayer of invocation, which was actually several weeks ago, I wasn't sure I was going to be back, but I have to say, as the psalmist says, I was glad when they said to me, come into the house of the Lord, and it is good to be back, definitely. Please join me in the reading of the scripture from Psalm 73, selected verses from Psalm 73. Truly, God is good to Israel, to those who are pure in heart. But as for me, my feet had almost stumbled. My steps had nearly slipped. For I was envious of the arrogant when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. But when I thought how to understand this, it seemed to me a wearisome task until I went into the sanctuary of God. Then I discerned. When my soul was embittered, when I was pricked in heart, I was brutish and ignorant. I was like a beast toward you, O Lord. Nevertheless, I am continually with you. You hold my right hand. You guide me with your counsel, and afterward you will receive me to glory. Whom have I in heaven but you? And there is nothing on earth that I desire besides you. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. For behold, those who are far from you shall perish. You put an end to everyone who is unfaithful to you. But for me, it is good to be near God. I have made the Lord God my refuge, that I may tell of all your works. Please join me in the prayer of invocation. Lord God, it is good to be in your house. As we struggle in the outside world with all the distractions, all the things that move us away from you, all the things that just occupy our mind and instead of being occupied in your sanctuary, Lord, we pray that there, throughout our week, we would learn to have times with you where we are in your presence and your presence alone in prayer. It is in those times that the rest of the world is just vanity, that the rest of the world peels away, and we understand that our closeness to you is really all that matters. And may this time in your presence here as we worship corporately together, may this time be one of those times where we really have a sense of being in your sanctuary, in your presence, and that those other things of the world, those vanities that surround us day by day, moment by moment, throughout the week, may those vanities disappear during this time, and may we just be in your presence, and that all we do and say in our prayers, in our singing, in our message would be to bring you glory here today. We thank you that we can be here like this. We don't take that for granted. We don't take our next breath for granted. And so, Lord, thank you for inviting us into your presence, and we just invite you into ours. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Together, let us, in a way, proclaim what we believe through a general confession. And the people of God said, Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like lost sheep. We have offended against thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done. And we have done those things which we ought not to have done, and there is no health in us. O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Spare them, O Lord, which confess their faults. Restore them that are penitent, according to thy promises, declared unto mankind in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of thy holy name. Amen. From Psalm 32, portion of the psalm, You are my hiding place, which we know well. Remember, this is a round, so we'll start together the whole song, and then this group starts the repeat, and you guys come in when you're asked to do that. You probably already know where. So let's stand together and remind ourselves that Jesus is our hiding place.
Fill my heart with songs of deliverance.
With your likeness, let me
For the children's sermon, which includes all of us, we have a song from Psalm 23 from the Psalter, 23F, if you'd like to pull that out and look at it, the notes are there, 136, page 136. Join in when you feel comfortable doing that, and it has goodness and mercy in it.
Shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me lie in pastures green. He leads me by the still waters. His goodness restores my soul, and I will trust in you. I will trust in you alone, for your endless mercy follows me, your goodness will lead me home. He guides my ways in righteousness, and he anoints my head with oil. Overflows with joy. I feast on his pure delights, and I will trust in you alone, and I will trust in you alone, for your endless mercy follows.
Thank you, Mr. Davis. I love that little chorus, and I love the 23rd Psalm, and I just am itching to talk to you about it, because really, I mean, many of you know the 23rd Psalm, and I got to be careful not to get off my script here, but that's the whole Christian life right there, you know, in that little psalm that we all can probably quote, because it's talking about going through life to God's house. And that's what we're going to be talking about over these next few weeks. And I told you, we're going to build a house, a little pretend house here. And we're going to talk about how God builds his house. Now, sometimes we talk about house being heaven. But you know what? God's house is everything. It's not just what we call heaven. It's what I call the cosmos. It's everything that is made is God's house. And his plan is that we would live with him forever and ever in his house. Now, last week, talked about, actually, I should probably do our Bible verse, so go ahead to, we'll just use that one that we did today, okay? Go to the next one, would you please, for time's sake. So let's say Psalm 23 together. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Psalm 23, 6. I want you kids to all learn that verse. That whole psalm would be good. Now, last week we talked about the plans, right? This, I showed you this last week. This is the blueprints of my house, built 20-some years ago. Mr. Waddell helped me build that house, actually. He didn't draw these, but he drew some that were better than these. Yes. Oh, I knew that was going to get lots of questions. So, quick questions. Yes. What? Carter? Yeah, that's your house. You will inherit it someday, no doubt. No, that was Carter Lumberyard. Yes, Ryan. I'm going to tell you that right now, okay? Because every house has to be built on something solid. And so if you look at the little picture there, this is what we're going to hopefully end up with. That's just a drawing, but we'll have one up here. But there's something underneath the house to hold it up. And that something is what we're going to talk about today. I guess I can't take your questions, kids. I'm so sorry. I'd love to, but we'd spend an hour here. What a house is built on is the rock, okay? Now, we're calling it bedrock. So I'm not going to lift this up. You kids want to get up and touch this? Come on up. Feel this, okay? This is real rock. It's from Mr. DeHaas. It's called sandstone. And but it's not really good bedrock, but it's going to do. Isn't that hard? Yeah. Did you want to touch it, you guys? No? Okay. All right, so bedrock is underneath all the house, and it's what keeps it from falling down. Now, I just got to say something else, a little distraction here, because yesterday was 9/11. It was the anniversary of the terrible things that happened in New York City. And I happen to know quite a bit about the World Trade Center because I studied it for my other job, which is consulting work. And I know that when they built the World Trade Center towers back in the 1960s, they had to dig deeper and deeper and deeper to find the bedrock. They had to go 60 feet down just to get to the hard, hard rock so that when they built that 1,000-foot building, it wouldn't collapse. It wouldn't. Well, it collapsed not because of the bedrock problem. It collapsed, of course, because of the terrible tragedy of the planes going into it. And if you have questions about that and you haven't heard about that, you need to talk to your parents about it. But we're talking about bedrock today, and we're talking about how God has to build his house on bedrock as well. The bedrock that God builds his house on is God himself. All right? And so this piece of rock is going to remind us of God. God himself. Now, I know, again, for some of you, it's hard to make an analogy. It's like, that doesn't look like God. And I know that's not God, and that's not what even God looks like. But there is something about this rock that is like God. And that's what we're talking about here is bedrock. All right? Let me keep talking for a little bit more, all right? And so God builds his house on bedrock, and he builds it on himself. And the whole house of the universe, the cosmos, everything else is built upon that solid, absolutely solid foundation, God himself. And now he could have maybe built it on something else, but he didn't. He built it on himself. So here's the lesson that's really, really important for understanding for kids. This is so important. In fact, I'm going to say that every week, and you'll probably get tired of me saying this is the most important thing. But everything that I'm going to be talking about here is so, so important for you to remember, especially at this stage of life. And as you get older and go into high school, and then some of you are going to be going to college, you're going to be learning a lot of things about our world. And a lot of what you learn will not be true. A lot of what you are going to be taught is false because it doesn't understand the bedrock. All right. Now, who did I say the bedrock of the whole house is? Yeah. God. Yeah, that's right. It's God. But let me give you something very specific to remember about that. All right. In Colossians 1:17, it says that Jesus, God, is before everything. He existed before all things, and by him, all things hold together. Jesus is what I call the glue of the cosmos. Jesus is what holds everything together in this whole world. He's not only the foundation for it, God, but he's also who holds it all together, because if he didn't hold it together, it would all fly off in a million pieces. He's the only, God is the only foundation. He's the only solid bedrock that is capable of holding everything up. And so even as big as the universe is, and I could talk about this stuff for so much. I've got this wonderful National Geographic map that I showed the church many, many years ago that's called the significance chart, and it shows the entire universe that, as we kind of imagine it to be, and how we're just one tiny little speck in the solar system, let alone in our galaxy and in the multiple galaxies and then in the entire universe. God is bigger than all those things, all these things, and holds it all up. But secondly, if God is that strong, he's the bedrock. He's also the one who holds it all together. So the third thing is that he takes care of what he has made. Now, next time, we're going to be talking about what gets built on the bedrock. And so you'll see that picture there. It's got bedrock right at the bottom, if you can see it. And then it's got those cement blocks that we're calling the foundation. And so next week, I'm going to bring in some pretend blocks, and we're going to start building our house. And we're going to see how God's house is the place that he wants to live with us forever and ever. All right, let's stand together and pray. Lord, as I prayed last week, I'm praying very specific prayer for each of the minds of these children. I'm praying that you would build new circuits of knowledge and information processing in their little brains, and that that information processing pattern that is being established in their minds will always be with them. Whatever college course, whatever atheistic, agnostic, skeptical professor they may have, whatever they may hear, may they always know what was true. And then, Lord, may you haunt them with the truth so that they can never run away from it. And Lord, I pray that we would see each one of these children in your house, not just right now, but forever, as we've been singing about, that we will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Lord, I pray that for these children. I pray it for my own grandchildren every day. We don't want to be without them through eternity. And I just pray, Lord, that you would draw them to yourself so that we could dwell forever in your house. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we do rejoice that you are the bedrock of our lives. You are a firm and solid foundation for all of those whom you have called unto yourself through your Son, Jesus Christ. That grace that is covering us also draws us to the deepness, the depths, of the foundation of you. And Lord, we thank you that you don't leave us where we are, but you draw us deeper each and every day. Sometimes through trials, Lord, sometimes through pain, you draw us to a place of understanding and relationship and trust in you. And so this morning, Lord, as we come before you, we acknowledge that at times we flee from you, we push away from you. We acknowledge that we desire our sinfulness over you. And Lord, we come confessing our sins before you, before the one and true and holy God, the one who has laid a foundation for us in a world of sinking sand. You are the rock that never turns, the rock that never shifts. You are forever ours. And so, Lord, forgive us of our sins. Cleanse us from our unrighteousness, Lord, and help us to see once again those sins were placed upon Christ Jesus, who cried out in truth, "It is finished." And the punishment was paid. And Lord, now you've brought us into a relationship that deepens us and brings us to a place where we can call out to you as Abba, as Father, and know and trust that you will hear us and that you will answer according to your good and perfect pleasure. So Lord God, we pray for our country. We pray for those who are hurting and lost. We pray for those who do not know the truth of your scripture, O Lord. And their names that we know in the realm of our lives, our friends, our family, our neighbors, they come to our minds even right now, Lord. Draw us to a time where we can share the truth with them. Prompt our spirits, Lord, that we can speak forth your gospel, your good news of salvation and forgiveness and truth in a world that shifts and turns, Lord God, that there is an anchor for every soul. Lord, we pray that you would give us these moments. And we ask, Lord, that you would bless our tithes and our offerings that we bring to glorify your name, to bless you, O Lord, and to further the ministry of your kingdom. We thank you so much for Seminario Latino America Reformando, Lord, and we thank you so much for SRL and for the work that they're doing in down in the southern South America and Central America and all of the Latino areas. Lord, we pray for them right now for the 23rd. They have an important banquet coming up, one that would gather in funds, but also be a celebration of all that you have accomplished. And we pray, Lord, that you would bless them as they reach out to many. We pray for the speakers that will be involved in that as well, Lord, one who is even an astronaut to speak forth and to bring some news of the Lord to people. We pray for those teachers that are equipped during this ministry. We pray for the pastors that go out and proclaim to many others the truths of God's word as it is proclaimed. We thank you so much that our own Pastor Don participates and is part of this important endeavor, as well as many other professors and teachers. And so, Lord, we do pray a blessing upon them, and we ask, Lord, that you help us as we continue to participate in partnership with them. Father, we do pray for not only in remembrance for the 20 years of 9/11 and the victims that were lives were taken on that day, but the families that have remained and the people that have survived and suffered. We remember them, Lord, and we lift them up to you. And we pray, O God, that you would continue to call us as you did back then, call a whole nation back to you in prayer, Lord God. How far have we all slidden in 20 years and our lack of awareness of you? Lord, draw us back to you again, not just as a reminder from this, but as the truth that we all need to stand. We ask you to draw us back to yourself even today, as we study your word and we worship you. In Jesus' name, amen.
join the psalmists with the singing of the psalm before our lesson tonight. It's from Psalm 119, verses 65 through 72. You know this.
Oh, this morning, would you open up your Bibles with me to Psalm 119? Here we are studying together God's Word and the celebration of God's Word in this psalm. 176 verses of praise to the Word of God. A song that comes forth from the psalmist's heart and mind and pours forth to us. Really words of praise from God to us regarding His Word, and a celebration that is good for us to know. Today we're working on the letter Tet. Each eight octaves of this whole psalm starts with a Hebrew letter of the alphabet. And so for every eight groups, you'll see a new letter of the alphabet, and this letter is Tet. Tet. Our sermon title today is Affliction is Good for Us. Now, if yours says, is God for us? Well, we made a slight correction. That was a spelling mistake. Affliction is good for us. Do we get it? Oh, I told you, these are going to get worse and worse. Affliction can be good because it reminds us of God's goodness and spurs us towards obedience. Affliction can be good. Now, why in the midst of studying Scripture and praising Scripture is suddenly the psalmist talking about affliction, worried about affliction. In many ways, we all have to deal with a reality, and that's what I love about these songs. It deals with the reality of being a faithful servant of God in the midst of a fallen world, doesn't it? Listen to how he even speaks about it. He speaks about the fact that hardship is a fact of life. Loss, grief, pain, tragedy, obstacles. All of us have gone through these things. Others lying about you, deceiving you, trying to manipulate you, trying to get you to do what they desire, trying to control you. This often happens as well. If we didn't have God in His precious word, we would crumble under the pressure of affliction. But instead, when affliction comes because of His word, what happens to us? We grow. We actually grow in affliction. If we didn't have God's precious word, we would be steered off course by those who speak falsehood. And they would actually define us rather than God defining us according to His word. But we do have His word. And in so, our afflictions, though they might be many, have purpose. And it's actually good for us, as the psalmist proclaims. But do we get it? Do we get it? This morning, as we hear this octonary song of praise in the Psalms of God's Word, the context begins to grow in the writer's appreciation of how he sees the truth of God, how it brings him to this very precious time of understanding and truth, and how it promises that God never fails. In fact, His word has grown so precious to Him that there is no equal. It doesn't matter how much money or wealth or anything that you throw His way, it will not compare to the word of God in His life. So let's begin this. Let's see if we get this. Well, first let's deal with the letter itself, tet. Tet, as I've described to you in many ways, each letter of the Hebrew alphabet, the letter itself has a meaning and it has a symbolism. And we can even draw more from the word and more from the very letters of God as we just look at each one of these. And tet, as you can see this, kind of turned over, this means a basket or an open container or surrounding something. Now, many of us would look and go, okay, yeah, I kind of see that looks a little bit like a basket. Hold on to the understanding of this word of an open container, surrounding, because it does come into play many times. As you can imagine, the letter that begins in each one of these stanzas begins with tet. So each word that follows is important and true. The first is what we see as we begin this. You have dealt well with your servant, O Lord, according to your word. Teach me good judgment and knowledge, for I believe in your commandments. Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I keep your word. You are good and do good. Teach me your statutes. The first thing that we learn from verses 65 to 68 is God is good. God is absolutely good. You have done good to me, Lord, and when I have strayed, you've disciplined me, you've brought me back, you do good to me, Lord. And the first part of this, we're going to kind of break this down into two parts. The first part is he keeps his promises. Look at verse 65. You have dealt well with your servant according to your word. You promised me that you would do well with me. And what have you done? Good. You have done me good. In fact, that word for well that's used in the ESV in the Hebrew is the word tov or tob. Kind of the B and the V kind of blend together depending on what era you're listening to Hebrew. Tob, your word is good. This word Tob, I want you to write that down and remember this word, T-O-B or T-O-V. I'll probably say it two different ways several times before you today. You have been good to me. And you know what, Lord? You promised me that you would. Where? Where did God promise that he would be good to the author? In his very word. See, God has already given us the promises of blessing and hope and joy and purpose to us. Why do we look for the shelves in the Christian section, maybe that say self-help? Have you seen those? In the Christian section at the bookstores, self-help. You know what we don't need? Self-help. Self-help's what's got us here. What we need is God's help. We need Christ to come and give us the proclamations that are going to come true regardless of us. And these are the promises that are found in his word. This is why Spurgeon said this: "This kindness of the Lord is, however, no chance matter. He promised to do so, and he has done it according to his word. It is very precious to see the word of the Lord fulfilled in our happy experience. It endears the scriptures to us. It makes us love the Lord of the scripture. The book of providence tallies with the book of promises. What we read in the pages of inspiration, we meet with again in the leaves of our lives story." Thank you, Spurgeon, for those beautiful words. The psalmist proclaims an excellent use of adversity in the goodness of God because he sees God as afflicting him with purpose. So the first part is we know God keeps his promises. This is why God is good. See, if he didn't keep those promises that he made, he would be a liar, or he would be a trickster, or he would be something other than the God who proclaims and holds to his promises fully and completely. He teaches us life's truths. He says this: "Teach me good judgment and knowledge, for I believe in your commandments." This is kind of a subpart of him keeping his promises. What else does he teach us? He teaches us good judgment, good knowledge. Tov, judgment. Tov, knowledge. You're going to notice a repetition in here. God is what? Good. In fact, the very instructions that he gives us are good and necessary for us in our lives. The author is looking forward to them. They come from nowhere else. They only come from the Lord. And he says, "I believe in what you've spoken. I believe in your commandments. Give me more of that. Teach me more." He entreats the Lord once again with an imperative, praying to God for more understanding and more knowledge and more learning. I want to ask us, do we pray that every morning? Lord, give me more knowledge. Give me good understanding. Give me the stuff that only comes from where? Your word. You're starting to get the repetition, the idea of the whole theme of this song, right? Your word, your word. Brothers and sisters, do we wake up in the morning with a hunger and thirst for good knowledge, for good understanding? Or are we kind of starving a little bit? Are we a little bit anemic for the good things? And I'm not trying to just convict you. I'm convicting myself even as I'm preaching this because I realize what's the first thing I probably reach to in the morning after I wake up? My phone. Anybody else? Okay, I got one honest person. Thank you, brother. Thank you in the back. I got a few more. Yes. I start to realize that I'm reaching for this instead of reaching for what I truly need to begin the day in the truth and the knowledge of my life. I need the Word of God to be the first thing I reach for. I need it to be the very thing that I hunger for, and I entreat the Lord even before my feet hit the floor in the morning from my bed. Lord, teach me, please teach me good understanding and good knowledge, because what do I not have in my self-help? I don't have good understanding and I don't have good knowledge. In fact, if I follow my heart, as all my Disney movies and songs want me to do, I'm going to lead myself to destruction over and over and over again. I need somebody greater. I need someone who can understand what the world is about and what it means to go through life. And that's where the Lord is. It's how life was designed, to be in a relationship with the Lord, to be in obedience and to know who He is. He's made it clear what He desires of us, oh man. But to love justice and to do mercy and to walk humbly with our Lord. That means a change of our hearts and a reliance upon Him. But we struggle with this. Well, that's why He is good and we need Him, and He keeps His promises and we need those promises, and He teaches us and we need that too, because trials come in our lives, don't they? Trials come in our lives and He corrects us through the very affliction that He brings us. Verse 67, before I was afflicted, I went astray. Notice the timing on this. He says, before, Lord, you brought the discipline and the affliction to me, I was already walking away from you. I was already straying from your precepts, from your truth, from your good understanding and good knowledge. I was in the self-help aisle. And where was that leading me? Nowhere good. Lord, and then you brought affliction into my life. And don't you love how generic that term is? You brought affliction into my life. What does that cover? Everything. From loss, quick tragedy, long-suffering tragedy, physical issues, mental issues, financial issues. You brought these afflictions into my life, Lord, and you know what? That was everything that I needed. I needed you to bring that to me because I was going astray. I realized in those moments when you stripped everything else away, what's the one thing that remains that I have? I have you. I have your word. Everything else I can lose. I can lose my health. I can lose my wealth. I can lose all of these different things. They can be taken from me in an instant. And you do it for a purpose. But now I keep your word, he says. You have taught me the boundaries of obedience. And discipline, in discipline, you have brought me back to yourself. Job spoke of this. Let's talk about a guy who suffered affliction for the purpose of growing deeper with God. That was God's purpose in bringing affliction to Job, was to grow him deeper in relationship. Many of us would go, that's not fair. God doesn't operate on fairness. And we should all praise the Lord for that. He operates on drawing us deeper. Job 5, 17 through 18 says this, blessed is the one whom God corrects. So do not despise the discipline of the Almighty, for He wounds, but He also binds up. He injures, but His hand also heals. He brings that which will bring the most growth to us, the most glory to Himself. He is a good father who disciplines his children in love and sees them through their trials and their afflictions and their pain. And He even prunes us for a greater yield, hence the illustration up there, because what did the Son of God give as an understanding for us in our relationship with Him? John 15. John 15, the Lord says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Now, we all like being part of the true vine, right? But what do you think of when you see the vine dresser walking near? Oh boy. This is when those moments happen in our lives and things change and we're pruned in some way. He says this, every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. But every branch that does bear fruit, he what? Prunes. That it may bear more fruit. Already you are clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. Notice the very word of God is cleaning the disciples and making them pure and true. He says, abide in me and I in you. As a branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me, Christ says. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him will bear much fruit. But apart from me, you can do everything. Oh, nothing. Thank you for the clarification. You can do nothing apart from me. Are we starting to see that there's a necessity to the trials and the tragedies and the triumphs that God alone has brought to our lives? I mean, I could enumerate. You guys have heard me preach many times the various things I've gone through in my life. I fell on my head at 4 years old. I was in a coma for 8 hours. I couldn't read until the fifth grade. Our dear beloved Michaela was born with a birth injury, paralyzed her arm. I look at these moments and I think, Lord God, if I could have a time machine, how I would go change things. And then he goes, no, this is the best possible reality I created, and it was created for your good and for my glory. Do you believe this? Do you believe the trials and the afflictions and the things that I have brought your way are to galvanize you in the truth and to help you to understand who I am in your life as opposed to who you are? A greater understanding of how much you need me. Jesus said it himself. He said, apart from me, you can do nothing. Nothing. So this brings us to the whole idea, how else can we ever say anything of God except for the fact that he is good? In fact, he's the very definition of good. Look at verse 68. You are good and you do good. Not only in your person and your being are you good, O Lord, but everything that comes out of you is good. Teach me your statutes. Hear the plea again. He's realizing how great God is, that God can even use the worst possible things in our lives and move us through to a greater understanding and a greater reliance upon him. I had a dear brother in the Lord out of my previous church. His name was Bob. And Bob shared with me his testimony, how he came to Christ, how he gave his life to the Lord, how he understood the saving grace of God. And you know when that happened? It was the day his son was killed. The day his son was killed by a 300-year-old tree that fell on a tent where his son was helping out at an event and shouldn't have been there. He swapped with somebody else and he came early and the tent fell as the tree fell down and took his life. And he knew right then, he said, Pastor, I knew right then that God owns every single moment of our life and he has a day for all of us. And he said, my heart was broken. I was there with the Lord that day. And I'll tell you, Bob loved the Lord. I mean, he loved the Lord with a passion. But it's in those moments of trial that we see God is good, because God saved him through even this trial. I wanted to bring up this word tov, and I bring up the three letters that make up the word tov. Tet, wa, beth are the letters. And we've dealt with wa and we've dealt with beth, but we haven't fully touched on all of tet. Tet is that open container. If you remember wa was the tent peg in the ground. It kind of looks like a tent peg. Remember, you're reading now from right to left. It's a tent peg in the ground. It's security is what it symbolizes. An open container, security. And anybody remember what Beth meant? It's a tent. I want you to think for a second. In the word tov, which means good, in the word tov, which happens six times in these eight verses, by the way, over and over and over again. It's not just a noun, it's an adjective, it's a verb, over and over. It means a container secured in a tent. The word good means a container secured in a tent. All right, context is key. This author in the Psalms is thinking of what room, what place, what location that is a container secured in a tent when he uses the word tov. He's thinking about the very holy of holies, the place where God himself dwells, the only place that is good, God himself being good. The very word for good draws us into the very place that God's feet would rest upon the earth, where his presence would be in relationship with man. God himself in this place. He is the very definition of good. In fact, the word good draws us back to him. There is no one who does righteousness or goodness in any way compared to him. And in fact, if we think about this, we think about what was inside that open containered area within the tent. What was the one thing that was in there that was so special? The Ark of the Covenant, in which was supposed to be the footstool of the Lord as he was upon his throne in heaven. That was a very meeting place, a very special place in which only the high priest once a year could go in and atone for the sins of the people. But was that an open container? Or did it have a lid closed to it? Was there an opening to that place, or was it veiled? There was a heavy curtain. We read about this in Exodus, and we read about it in Deuteronomy, that the curtain that was made was heavy and woven and beautiful as you see it before you. But at one point in time, that curtain was torn from top to bottom. Matthew 27, 51, Jesus is upon the cross at Gethsemane. And behold, the curtain of the temple was torn in two, from top to bottom, and the earth shook and the rocks split. Jesus, by his death, opened the container of God's presence and goodness, and it spilled forth to all of us in Christ. His goodness overwhelms us like a tidal wave as we come to him and we look to his sacrifice on our behalf. In fact, in Mark chapter 10, verse 18, a man who was rich came up to Jesus and said, "Good teacher." And I love Jesus' reply. What did he say? "Why do you call me good?" And the question from the man was, "Good teacher, what do I have to do to inherit the kingdom of God?" You guys probably all remember this story. And Jesus starts with, "Why do you call me good? For God alone is good." Really drawing that parallel. God alone is tov. Why are you calling me tov? And the gentleman, Jesus says, "Well, what is written in the scriptures?" And he proclaims to him, you know, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind. Do these things and you shall live." And the man says, "I've done all of this from my youth." And Jesus gives him one more command. He says, "Then go forth and sell everything you have and follow me." And what happened to that young man? He walked away weeping because he had much value. And then Jesus turns to his disciples and he has a lesson with his disciples. And he talks about how hard it is for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of heaven. And finally, Peter cries out, or one of the disciples cries out, "Lord, how is it that any of us can be saved then?" And what does Jesus respond? With man, it's impossible, but with God, all things are possible. Why? Because God is good. He is good. And He alone has the power and the authority to change our lives. What was really the rich man's issue? It wasn't that he loved wealth a whole lot. It's because he thought that he had to do something. He was still in the self-help aisle. He said, "What do I have to do?" And Jesus gave him one more commandment. "Well, do this." And what couldn't he do? He truly couldn't. He truly couldn't do it in his own flesh. None of us can. That's why God is good. That's why He is the one who intervenes for us. That's why He is the one who's torn the curtain. That's why I want more from You, Lord. I want more of You. I want more of Your Word. I desire it. Are you starting to see where the psalmist is going as they reflect in the truth of God's Word and the effects of His Word in his life and how it's seen him through such trials and tribulations and has brought him to a greater place in the Lord? But then he faces some other issues. "Lord, the insolent smear me with lies. But with my whole heart I keep Your precepts. Their hearts are unfeeling like fat, but I delight in Your law." Here's the truth. As much as he's on a joyful high of being in the presence of the Lord and knowing His truth, he's still brought down to earth by the afflictions of the day, by the trials that he's still going through. He realizes that God has brought him to great heights out of those dark valleys. But then he's very honest with the Lord. He's like, "Lord, you know what? I'm still going through one of those dark valleys. This time it's others smearing lies about me." Now, the term I said that God grows us in the gristle of affliction, the gristle being the fat of affliction. What does he accuse those who are speaking against him arrogantly? They're the ones with fattened hearts. They're the ones who basically are the ones who are seeking to try to change his life and trying to direct his life because they are actually defining him. He says that they're liars in verse 69. They speak untruth of me, meaning they're not speaking what? They're not speaking God's word, which is truth. They're not telling him of who he is in Christ, but they're telling him of their own understanding of him. They smear. The word for smear is they coat over or they whitewash. They're basically covering my whole life with all of their perceptions and all of their understanding of how the world works and how they actually want me to be. They're trying to define me. Does that sound familiar? Perhaps the way social media defines Christians today, evangelicals, and has taken the word, which means the good news of Christ Jesus, and has turned it into a political thing and has flipped it over on its head so that we're now the evil ones, defining us, for us, defining it to the world. Job said this of his good friends who came and sat with him. For 7 days, they sat with him in silence. That's good friends. And then they open up their mouths in his affliction. And he says this in Job 13, "As for you, you whitewash with lies, worthless physicians, you all," he says to his friends. The psalmist in Psalm 109:2 says this, "For wicked and deceitful mouths are open against me, speaking against me with lying tongues. They encircle me with words of hate and attack me without cause." When the truth of the matter is, we come proclaiming the love and the forgiveness of God upon sinners, and the world says, "Shh, we don't want to hear any of that. How dare you call us sinners?" I'm just pointing to God's word. We're sinners in need of salvation. I'm one beggar who found bread telling you where to go get the bread. How dare you call me a beggar? We realize that these lies are so ingrained in us. In fact, the serpent within the garden is the first one to whitewash the people of God with lies. He covered them with lies. He redefined their relationship with God. And he redefined their own identity. And you know what's the worst part? Adam and Eve believed him. And they let those lies define them. And it led them to the very actions that all of us would have done too. Why did they do this? Because their hearts are callous. That word for fat can also mean the word callous. It literally means, though, gross like fat. I appreciate, Ron and Glenda, that we sang of the word gross in the psalm. I was getting a little chuckle out of that. I like that. But it really literally means gross like fat. Their hearts have become gristle. There's a movie, and I'm not supporting any movies. I'm just using this as a reference. The movie The Great Outdoors with John Candy. I don't know if any of you've seen that, but they're in this old tavern and they're ordering up food, and he sees one thing on the menu and it says the old 96er, and he says, the old 96er, what's that? That's a 96 ounce rib. Or not rib, but ribeye steak. And if you can eat it all, you get the whole meal for free. So we go through this whole montage of him eating bite after bite after bite of a 96-ounce steak. And finally, he's shaking. He eats the very last bite. And he goes, oh, I'm done. And the gentleman's so impressed. And they look over to the chef and he goes, you're not done. And on the plate is this disgusting long length of gristle of fat. And John Candy's eyes just open up because he now realizes, oh, he's got to eat this gross fat. That's all that this is. When those whose hearts are hard are truly hardened, that they're unfeeling. They have no nerve endings within it. It's the heart that's made new by the Lord Jesus Christ and is renewed and restored, that beats to the sensitivity of God's word. That's open to even instruction and correction and can even have a perspective of having an eternal perspective, that this life is the temporary stuff and what he has for us is eternal. So even the trials that we go through right now have a purpose, but instead we listen to the people who have calloused hearts that are uncaring and insensitive, and we believe them. Well, he says here, what is our reaction to all of this? What happens when those who smear us, and because their hearts are calloused, what do we do? Because God is good, what do we do? Well, we have to back up for a second and consider this. He basically says, your word is my wholehearted delight. The more they smear me, the more I love your word, he says in verse 69. But my whole heart, I will keep your precepts. What is their heart like? Fat and unfeeling. What is the heart of the believer? It's open and desiring the instruction of the Lord. Hungering and thirsting for righteousness. Righteousness that doesn't come from us, doesn't come from our cell phones, doesn't come from social media, or as amazing as they might be, the movies. It comes only from the Word of God. And in that we delight. He says this. In verse 70, but I delight in your law. I truly have a joy when I read it. I truly understand what a blessing it is. I might not get it all, but I get that it's good for me. It's a joy to me to read and to understand and to know that the God of the universe has communicated to me his truth. And how the whole world, how all of mankind, how the God of all creation loves me and desires me. Desires me because he has set his affections on me, not because I have done anything in myself. Well, now that we delight in him, we now realize the purpose for our pain. Look at as he goes through 71 to 72. It is good for me that I was afflicted, that I might learn your statutes. The law of your mouth is better to me than thousands of gold or silver pieces. Basically, he sees profit in the pain that he endures. Romans 8:28 puts it this way, and we know for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. How many things work towards good? All things. There's a totality. There's a greatness. Even though the pain that we go through, God is working for that, for the good of us in our lives. Do we believe that? Do you believe that in your life, even though you're going through trials right now? Maybe you're even waiting for the doctor to call. Do you believe that that's the purpose of the Lord, to draw you even nearer, even now? He's even now stripping those other things away as you struggle with your finances. But he's still saying, I'm still here. The very one who crushes you also heals you. The very one who wounds you also binds you up. Or have our hearts become callous like the world, and we don't realize that he is waiting upon us and loves us. See, through affliction, we've become more reliant upon him and his word, hence why he allows it in the first place. He allows it that we would grow in him. 2 Corinthians, Paul also said this in 4:17-18. For the light momentary affliction is prepared for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison, as we look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal. We don't see the full plan of God, but we can trust in this, that when affliction comes our way, it has purpose. Let me read this from John Piper. Gave a great understanding, desiring God, five ways affliction helps. John Piper wrote this: affliction takes away the glibness of life and makes us more serious, so that our mindset is more in tune with the seriousness of God's word. And mark this, there is not a single glib page in the word of God. Affliction knocks worldly props out from under us and forces us to rely more upon God and brings us in tune with him and the aim of his word. Affliction makes us search the scriptures with greater desperation for help rather than treating it as a marginal part of our lives. Affliction also brings us to a partnership with Christ's suffering, so that we fellowship more closely with him and see the world more readily through his eyes. Paul saw this, as he said in Philippians chapter 3, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and may share his suffering and be like him in his death. And lastly, affliction mortifies deceitful and distracting fleshly desires, and so brings us into a spiritual frame and makes us receptive to the spiritual work of God and hearing his word. Since therefore Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves with the same way of thinking, for whoever has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin. 1 Peter 4:1. All leads to this very thing. We see the prophet. We understand that there is great treasure in God's word. Well, why? Because he has given us priceless promises. The law of your mouth is better to me than thousands of gold and silver pieces. in the end, he's saying, there is nothing you can give me that will equate with what I have already in God's word. You can give me all of the stacks of stocks, all of the money that can be raised, and I will look away from it and look to the word of God with joy. It's more valuable. In fact, that word for more valuable is once again the word tov. Is more good to me. Is gooder. It's more good to me than any temporary thing upon this earth. Why? Because the wealth that comes from your word is eternal. The wealth that comes from your word means something more. It's greater. And we know this because all of it, according to Paul, as he wrote to his spiritual son Timothy in 2 Timothy 3:16, he wrote, all scripture is breathed out by God. It's profitable for teaching, for reproofing, for correcting, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. What gem upon the earth, what coin or stacks of money compare to the idea and the truth that God has breathed forth truth for us to have? What else compares? Brothers and sisters, do you understand the joy? Do you understand that God is good? He is Tov. And that for us, we understand him and we know him because he has already spoken to us. So let us enjoy the goodness of our God. Do you get it? Do you get it? Affliction is good for us. Let's pray. Father, thank you that you have put in perspective the temporary afflictions of this life. You've given it purpose and have allowed secondary causes to bring us to pain and suffering at times, sometimes even directly firsthand, as in Job's case, Lord. Lord God, we pray that you would help us to put into perspective the afflictions that we're going through, physical, mental, emotional, relational, school, Lord, jobs. However we're suffering, we need to see that in light of your eternal purposes, that you have a purpose for it. And so, Lord God, we praise you that in the work of what you're doing, you are doing it for our good and for our benefit. And our prayer is, help us to know your word more. Teach me your good judgments and knowledge. In Jesus' name, amen.
To encourage you, we have 12 more sermons of 8 verses. I'm serious. I mentored a young man years ago, and after 2 years, one of the final times, he came in and said, he could call me Ron by then because he was over 21, but he said, Ron, there's one thing I don't like about you. I said, really? One thing you don't like about me? Everybody likes me. I'd be curious to know what that one thing is. You keep saying the same things over and over again. Really, I said. Why do you think? Because you're not doing what I'm telling you. So you've got 12 more chances. And you can be resistant to this, but the Word of God is so repetitive to remind us. And we get to sing about sorrow and pain, and it is well with my soul. When peace like a river. And you know the story of the man who wrote the poem. If not, look it up. Stand together as we sing once again, many times over many years, It Is Well With My Soul.
When peace like a river attends. Satan should buffet, the trial should come, let this blessed assurance control, that Christ has regarded my helpless estate, and has shed his own blood for my soul. It is well.
It is well.
Ask that the Sunday school teachers come forward, please. Come forward, Sunday school teachers. Love to have you up here. Come on up here, Mary. Come up on up here, Laura. Ron and Cindy. Excited to have all of these teachers. These are our Sunday school teachers for this new season, and we're so excited. We're going to pray for them and lift them up before the Lord. And as they go down to their classes, kids, you will hopefully you know where you're going. Otherwise, you can follow your individual teachers. Let's pray together, shall we? Okay, you guys can sit. What's that? Jackie, you have the list. Would you like me to read it? Okay. All right. Well, I will read this so you know. All right. First, let us pray. Father in heaven, we give to you this day. We celebrate that Sunday school has begun, both for adults and young students and these children. Lord, bless each and every teacher. We ask, Lord, that you would lift them up and that they would speak forth from your word and from your truth. And we thank you, O God, that you are the one leading us into understanding. And we pray especially for these little ones, that they would know and grow in you. And we ask, Lord, in Jesus' name, your blessing on this year. Amen and amen. Well, so we know each teacher, Laura, is going to be teaching forth Raylan and Piper and Finley. You can go with her as we go downstairs. And this is for the preschool and the kindergarten, the lower elementary, which will be Mrs. Cindy Rose, and also Vicki Kiger helping out with that as well. Is Emily home? Lydia and Violet and also Charlie. Just changed your name there. You're Charlie. Upper elementary is going to be taught by Mrs. Mary Hankins, and she will have Carter and Stanley and Nolan and Ryan and Lily. Also, in Ron DeHaas, Mr. DeHaas over there, he is going to have Brody and Andrew and Wesley and Bryn all together learning there. And then if you didn't hear your name, high school on up, 14 years old, Aaliyah, Brooklyn, Tristan, Jordan, Connor, Violet, Anya, Tanya, Ben, Chloe, Violet, and Logan, you guys come with us, the Steels, and we're going to teach you today. Yes. And one thing I forgot.
All parents need to pick up their kids, except for middle school and high school. They can be released on their own, but all elementary students need to be picked up by their parents. The teachers will not release them.
All right. Did you hear that? Parents, you will pick up your children. They will not be released until you yourself come and pick them up. Okay. All right. So even if the adult class is not done, please go help them at that time. Let us let's depart with this joyful just benediction from the Lord. Stand together. Come on, let's stand together. Y'all been sitting too long. To the God of grace and peace and joy, we give praise. For he is the one who has spoken forth to us by his very word. He has breathed the truth to us and has saved it for us to this very day. And Christ Jesus, who is the Word of God, is ours now and forever by his sacrifice and by his gift of salvation unto us. Thank you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, our one God forever. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you all today.